welcome live here to Racing Hotspot Weekend Roundup, February 15th edition. First show back with the whole gang, Dave and I and the Godfather. He's on the other side of the studio, so are you over there?
Yes!
All right!
I'm kind of enjoying the distance you put between us.
Why, you don't want to be rubbing shoulders like we were last year? I turned, it's like, oh, you just elbowed me to the side. All right. Anyways, so same protocol as last week. We're still working out the technical glitches, so if that TV goes, just roll with it. That's what we're going to do. Anyways.
So they were lying, so they show the same thing all the time? Is that how it works? Okay. Mm-hmm. So if people think I'm better looking, they can watch my screen?
Yeah.
I got you. Okay, that works.
All
right,
yeah.
I like that idea.
And it's also setting up for if in the future we do, like, double cameras, if, like, on me, the information's still on screen.
Right, like the last episode from last year when we did the contest on. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, so, all right, anyways. So, here we go, the show lineup. We have the Motorsports in 60, Supercross, the Sprint Unlimited recap, then we're going to take a break. We're going to come back to Daytona 500 qualifying recap, the Can-Am Duels starting lineup, and then we'll talk about the final lap. All the information, by the way, if you guys just want to quickly jump on and jump off, is right here on the big board, but I'd stick around because this should be interesting recapping everything. I'm pretty sure you guys can see this stuff. Pretty sure we're all good with the big board now that anything on here can
be seen.
I think
you may want to be writing a little bit bigger, but we'll see how it comes up.
Mm-hmm.
And then you take it from there.
We also have
this is the one thing I like to see.
We had a lot of stuff this weekend, and I didn't even put on the NHRA stuff.
I'm pretty much, most of what I'm going to talk about tonight is how amazing my new TV is.
Oh my god.
Oh my god.
So
you say, oh my god, you got to see it.
So, as you guys might have seen on social media, we are testing a new subject here on Racing Hotspot, NHRA, drag racing. I tried to use it in season one. And I confused myself because of how the bracket system is. I thought, like, round three, I had to recap the winners, and round two, I had to recap the winners, and round, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then I finally, last night, Fox Sports 1 was talking about it, and I understood it.
The finals.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, right. I was also 12.
Well, son, not a rule system that you're used to.
Yeah.
So
it took me, 5 years, but I finally got it, and we're going to just test trial it, see how people like it. So let's go. Motorsports in 60. Here we go. 60 seconds starts now. No need to turn your screen. I got right over here. Top Fuel had NHRA raced in California yesterday at Auto Club Speedway. Here are the winning the finals, drivers, and the winners and runner-ups. Losers. Anyways, Top Fuel. The winner was Steve Torrance with a speed of 326 miles per hour in about 4 seconds down the track. The runner-up was Doug Coletta with a speed of 324 miles an hour with, I believe it was like 0.04 of a second off of Steve. In funny car, the winner was Ron Capps with a speed of 324 miles an hour. And the runner-up was Del Worship with a speed of 324 miles an hour.
Worship.
Sorry. Pro Stocks. I know I didn't make it. Greg Anderson won that final with a speed of 207 miles per hour. And then Jason Line. Yep. Was the runner-up there with a speed of 209 miles an hour. But he still got beat. Which was crazy. So, new series. Dave kind of got what he wished for last year, filling up the whole 60 seconds. But
you didn't even get out of drag racing.
Well, that's it. That's all we got from the Motorsports in 60 this week. Next week, we'll recap the Xfinity and trucks and NHRA's off next week. But
okay.
See, the way I will usually do it is a new series we'll put in the Motorsports in 60. This way it's not like a segment, but we'll still talking about it, test
gotcha.
It for a couple weeks, and then we'll maybe throw it in as a segment. You know what I mean?
You are the producer.
See how ratings go and stuff like that, even though we only have like 10 people who watch the show. Anyways, Moving on to Supercross in San Diego, I stayed up late on Saturday night to see this race, and I followed it on Twitter, and I was watching it through my eyelids. So, the 450 Supercross, here is the top three. The podium, Ryan Dungey won yet again, Cole Seeley finished second, and Ken Roczen rounded out the podium. For the 250 class, this is the West Division, so there's an East Division that they'll be starting their season soon.
Savagi.
Yeah, because they were talking about it on Fox, and I had it down. Dang it. Cooper Webb finished second, and Christian Craig finished third, rounding up the podium for the 250 class in San Diego.
My recommendation to you in a case like that is keep a notepad next to you. And I can't think of the proper term for it, but when you write something...
pronunciation.
Yeah, when you write something in a pronunciation, there's actually a word for that. I can't think of what it's called.
It's like when in a textbook you have like this...
or even a dictionary.
Yeah.
So you have the... It tells you how to pronounce it.
Yeah, pronounce it.
And you may want to start, if you hear it, writing it your own way so that you know. This way we can... Because some of these names are really, really difficult. I mean, but they're from all over the world. You know, we start talking about Formula One again. We go back to
Hey, we got Peter Wong back this year, and I'm literally just gonna go. You recap the top five. I don't want to butcher them anymore. So now over to the Sprint Unlimited, which was raced on Saturday night and was the first race of the 2016 NASCAR season. I guess 500 officially kicks off the schedule, of course, but first race back in the off season. Here's the top five. Finishing fifth was Casey Mears. Kyle Larson finished fourth. Paul Menard finished third. Joey Logano finished second. And Denny Hamlin gambled and won.
Yeah, he did. I think he did a great job.
Yep. And
On the note of the Unlimited, I wanted to include, what a mess. How do these owners comfortably come into these things? I mean, what do they have to bring in? 3 18-wheelers worth of cars for each team? I mean, it's, you know, you're sacrificing the cars. You're sacrificing, chances are you're sacrificing a car for the Unlimited. That's like a 95% chance. And then you have the, what are they calling them now? The Can-Am?
Yeah, the Can-Am Duels.
Now, where did they get that as a sponsorship? Is that Can-Am is in,
I think, the off-road.
Can-Am Racing?
I think, like, it's the off-road, like, company.
Can-Am.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to look a little deeper into that, but kind of cool. But once again, they got to sacrifice cost for that. And that is, if I'm not incorrect, that is the Daytona 500 car.
Yeah.
So if they lose it during the twin Can-Am races,
then pull out the backup.
And a backup. Another one. Yeah. It's like, so how many cars do they arrive with? I mean, these things are almost $300,000 each.
Can't these haulers hold three cars?
I believe they can.
So you have the unlimited car, the primary. Well, car's pretty...
Generally, no, he's right. Generally, yeah, they usually have two.
But the trailers can, I think, hold three. Tight.
Possible.
I was going to say, you can talk.
You would have to move...
some equipment.
Lower equipment, I think.
The whole tool section would have to be moved up into the... lounge section in order to get another car in.
Well, I know they go above.
Right, normally. The two cars normally go above.
But there's, and that's with room. There's extra room there. There's buffer zone between them.
Yeah, which kinda have to not much, but they're pretty tight.
I don't know. You're talking about, they run what, 60 footers?
Yes, I think
so. The average trailer on the road is 53 foot. That's like a grocery trailer. You know, the average trailer that's... transporting goods is 53. They go 53 to 56, but I'm pretty sure what NASCAR is rolling with is 60 footers. So,
moving van.
It's really only 20 feet. Yeah, you're only talking 20 feet a pop. The car is probably what, about. Oh, you know what? I don't know what the actual dimensions are, but I'm going to guess probably about 15 feet.
More than that.
You think?
All right, never mind. Car bays can only hold two cars.
So in other words, they're coming down there.
And they, for a team like Gibbs, they might have another trailer with just cars in it.
Spare cars. Oh, that's true. They could do that.
Think about it, though.
And it could only be done. That could only be done on a track like Daytona, because it's the only place there's room for it.
They also do it when they go out west. Think about it. Stuart Joe Gibbs Racing sends just a trailer that has two decks of cars, and then they switch out.
Right, the unmarked ones. That's right. We showed that last year.
Well, not I just looked it up, and inside a NASCAR transporter, pretty cool.
Well, I know, because you have to have a buffer in between the cars.
Yeah.
So if the trailer is only 60 feet, you're literally, you're talking only leaving 10 feet in between two cars.
Not much.
So, unless you use the lower floor. But then again, if you're doing like what Joe Gibbs did last year, where he, in order to save the money, ran the cars out there.
Yeah.
And then transfer them over to the actual marked vehicles.
I mean,
then you don't have the tools, you don't have the pit equipment, you don't have anything else in there but cars.
Daytona has enough room in their parking lots.
Daytona definitely has the room. Talladega definitely has the room. But you can never pull off some kind of a specialty race at like a place like Howard Track Loudon. It's just not going to happen. There's not enough room there. I mean, you could probably do it if you really, really wanted to go nuts, but you'd be moving trucks back and forth. And
well, think about it, though. On Sunday, they have those blue trucks that pull in. So if NASCAR did a specialty race at our track, then maybe they just say, okay, no modifieds, and they'll just park the extra trailers right in turn one and two. Think about it.
Yeah, man, I'd rather see the modifieds.
But,
those are all special races.
But yeah, I hear what you're saying. The Sprint Unlimited cars are literally, we need the steering wheel for the cup car for Sunday, for the 500 at least.
Since you just looked it up, does it give you the length of the car? Like, what is a sprint car? It's going to probably give you inches, but that's easy enough to figure out mathematically.
I don't know. Hold on.
Well, I know that they're smaller than they appear. Like, when you're standing next to one, it's not quite as big as you would think it is if you just watched it on TV. But it has to.
Each transporter is up to 80 feet long.
What?
For the cup,
I believe it.
For the Cup and Xfinity Series, they'll use the Featherlight trailer. Each transporter is up to 80 feet long, and the semi plus the trailer can weigh up to 80,000 pounds. The average cost of a transporter is $500,000.
Well, honestly, that's also special registration, special taxes, all the above, because anything larger than 60 feet is you're paying extra for big time when it comes to federal permits and, you know, highway permits, licensing.
The NASCAR Hall of Fame has a transporter inside that's on display for fans to walk through.
And?
Yeah.
Does it say what size it is?
80 feet.
Well, I'm guessing they're going to be between 60 and 80, depending on the
team. It says right here that the Cup and Xfinity haulers are 80 feet with the truck and trailer.
I thought it says as big as.
Oh, with the tractor.
With the truck, yeah, with the semi.
Oh, with the tractor.
Oh, yeah, that makes a lot more sense.
You've got to remember the vehicle.
So I was on the money.
I was going to say,
I was
going to say that an 80-foot trailer is, most of our roads are going to have a hard time with that.
I'm thinking even my buddy Tom McCrone would be a little questionable about trying to drive that damn thing.
Can you picture coming off of 393 onto 103?
Through the curves?
The turn?
Can I? Of course I can.
Not with an 80-footer? No.
You have to go through it like a true race driver. You got to go
all the way out, yeah.
Yeah, that would be tight. That's not the only place. I mean, if you really think about the exit off of 93 to get to Daytona.
Yeah.
It's a big old loop.
Whoa, that's a
and
big
loop. And
that's
a tight loop. So that would be kind of, you'd have to literally be on the outer edge and take that all the way around and real slow-like and probably have to have police there for when you came out of it. You know, they got to stop the traffic and all that stuff, but they do that anyway.
Well, I mean, think about it. I wonder if teams have like meetings of like multiple drivers, of course, and they go, all right, you've been here the longest at these three tracks, you're the one driving off the highway when you get there, just so you know. Right? You know how to drive corners.
Relatively confident that the drivers that drive those trucks are very experienced and they have no problem. They probably, nothing personal against all of our boys here, but when it comes to real road driving, truck driving, better drivers than even these guys. I don't think they want to be doing 200 miles an hour. But
just think of the fact that the way they park at the tracks and pull out at the tracks.
Think about when
they're side by side like this, and they would just come right out. And no problem.
Do you know what the average distance is between the vehicles?
3 feet, right? 3 or 4 feet?
Close.
No, I don't know.
Never actually looked it up? Nothing?
No, never looked
it up. 30 inches.
Huh?
30 inches is enough for basically a decent-sized jackman to walk between. That's pretty much what it comes down to. So it's a matter of, can you walk between them? Because if they had to, they could be even tighter.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm pretty sure, actually, they are at Bristol. I think Bristol is 18 inches. Somewhere around that. So your jackman's going down sideways. I use jackman as an example because they're generally big guys.
But we used to watch the truck series haulers back out of the infield, and we wouldn't even be watching the race. We'd be like, whoa.
And you got like one guy guiding them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Me, I would want like six guys. Can you point out everything?
Everyone with the radio. All right, clear here. All right. Where?
Well, it could get messy.
But... Yeah.
And at that price tag, that wouldn't be a good thing.
What'd you say they were?
I can see some of the owners getting a little upset if they damage those trucks.
Especially considering most of them update those trucks once a year. Now, that's crazy. That's the five, but you're talking about $500,000, you get a four-car team.
Alright, so, the Unlimited Wreckfest.
Pretty much it.
Learned a lot, though. Learned why we have spotters, Carl Edwards. And we learned that tires might be an issue. How many accidents did we have that had a tire-related issue?
Out of curiosity, aren't tires always an issue?
Not really much Daytona.
No, I think it's just about every race and every series, for that matter, because even the, which I didn't get to cover with you, with the 24-hour. Mm. There were a ton of tire issues, and that's a completely different tire. I mean, that's not even remotely close to the Goodyear we're looking at over there. Mm. Very different. And they still had a lot of tire issues. I mean, it's, you know, wear. Mm-hmm. All the rubber, all the above. And they're not all the same, and they never will be. They try to be.
Mm-hmm. Everything okay over there?
I'm looking. I'm
watching. Which is deep there.
It's really good.
The fire... Yeah.
It will change the batteries. Anyway.
hard hit by Brian Vickers.
Yeah, that was, actually, that was quite a... I didn't make any notes, unfortunately, but...
You know what's funny? When that happened...
I did catch that.
That right there is an accident that shows you how wide Daytona is. People always are like, wow, that track's really narrow. But when a 18-foot... How long are those cars?
I asked you to look that up.
All right.
Hello.
When a car like that can completely from the bottom lane spin all the way up and
flush,
it's like whoa. Hell.
I was a little worried about him. It was pretty hard hit, but those soft walls are amazing.
Well, it's come a long, long way.
Yeah. And on that note. What do we have? 3 days till the anniversary of the loss of Dale Earnhardt, and it's been 15 years already. Mm. 15 years already. I mean, that is utterly amazing. But then again, we just, not that long ago, not to exclude them, but we lost the space shuttle with our own local celebrity. And I can't believe how long ago that was.
Krista McAuliffe, you're talking about, but, right?
Yeah, I don't remember how many years they said it was at this point in time, but I do remember I was in, I believe, elementary school, and you and I were homesick together.
Yeah.
You were in the kitchen making soup or something, and I was watching the launch, and I told you that they had just launched, and then it blew up. And it's just, wow, it was really that long ago. I'm in my 40s now, so elementary school, that was a while ago. I waved goodbye to that quite a while ago.
So the wheelbase of a NASCAR Sprint Cup Series Generation 6 race car He's 110 inches, which calculates to 9 feet.
That's between
about,
wheels.
About, yeah. So
now you got extensions on either end.
Another foot.
But doesn't give you a total length.
More than.
There has to be a rule that says what the total length is.
Go back to Google.
It has to fit the template, so it has to.
Yeah, because if you could have a pointier, if you could have a pointier nose, you got an advantage. So there has to be a. It has to be something that says the total length. Just put in total length.
I did.
Oh, I love it when you ask for something and it has to give you 900,000 pieces of information.
I just jumped to Wikipedia. Don't tell my some of my teachers they hate this site. It's fake information. Anyways, if you look at Jeff Gordon's car right there, estimate probably about a foot for the front, maybe foot and a half for the front. Here. You look at Gordon, I'll look at Keselowski. I estimate about probably a foot and a half for the front.
Just said that backwards, but okay.
Yeah, I know. And then foot and a half, 2 feet from the back. Maybe 3 feet from the wheelbase.
I would say 3 feet in the back and at least a foot and a half to 2 foot in the front.
To the breach of the nose?
Yeah.
I'm surprised you can't find that information.
I know. Want the car tomorrow information?
Nope.
Me neither.
No, we got rid of those, thank God.
All right, so moving on. We're under a slight duress tonight because we're actually having another snowstorm.
Yeah. No school tomorrow! Really banking, hoping. Either way, I have a 2-hour delay because of teacher workshops.
Yeah, you probably won't have school tomorrow. It's going to turn into a mess, but I think it turns into a mess too late.
Anyways, so, any other words on the Unlimited? Congrats to Denny Hamlin on your...
Congratulations to Denny Hamlin. It was a great race, and you're right, you gambled and won.
Now,
beyond that, it was a mess.
One question for you.
I'd hate to be an owner.
You're a new crew chief, right? Like Denny Hamlin's. And you're at the Unlimited. Do you kind of just go, what the heck of it? Let's gamble. Hey, Denny, what do you think of this?
No way in hell. He had a dozen people sitting behind him with calculators going.
Yeah, but could have that been... Hey, guys.
So what are you saying? That it wasn't actually a gamble? It was a calculated gamble?
A calculated risk. I don't believe those guys gamble at anything anymore.
Still, though, it's a risk. You said it. It's still a risk. So
calculated risk.
But as a new crew chief, do you take that risk? Just for
the
heck of it.
Absolutely. I take the advice of the guys that work for me.
The advice of those guys back there with the numbers crunching? You bet.
I definitely take the advice of the guys that work for me, without a doubt.
But I mean, because it's the Unlimited and there's no points, and it's almost like the All-Star race. It's like,
actually, if you read
up
on it,
this as a learning
first
experience.
Place was really the only thing that meant anything in that race.
Really?
Very little dollars from there on out.
Yeah,
it was the big bucks were in winning and winning alone. So it's like I was saying earlier, I mean, you got all these owners that it's like sacrificial cost. You know, you're taking it out there and you're shooting for that big prize, but if you ain't number one, you ain't winning that big prize. I mean, it's crazy. Like, just the M&M's car, Kyle Busch's car, looking at what happened to that thing shortly before the end of the race, it was just like, that thing's just going to go back to the shop and go into a scrap heap. I mean, they might pull some parts out of it, but what was left? The whole front end was, which means your radiator, all the front of the engine's gone. Most likely the engine's gone because it probably lost its cooling. And
the uneducated look at that and go, just hammer the nose down. And we're looking at that going, all right, let's look in the inside of this race car. You have...
I'm looking at that going,
You're looking at it going, you have the radiator, you have all these inside components.
What was that?
That was a ribbon that I hid in here for me to remember last October. Okay. And I just found it. Yeah.
Not doing you a whole lot of good now.
You just look at the front end of it and you have all this front components that you need for a race car.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. Whereas, and his car was destroyed.
Yeah.
And that went to, how many cars actually finished the race?
I think they said like 4 out of 25 were unscathed.
Two.
There was two, I think. Only two made it.
Unscathed.
Everybody else had some damage. Not bad damage, but some damage.
Danny's car did have damage.
And then it was...
They were calling him an unscathed, so it was the two... That's what I heard. And, you know, maybe people heard otherwise. I don't know. I'm not perfect.
But...
Well, yes, I am, but...
Hamlin had damage.
People would argue with that anyway.
Hamlin had damage. Logano had no damage. Larson had no damage. Mears had no damage, and Menard had no damage.
I had heard two.
Because Fox Sport, Mike Joy, it said, guess how many cars were unscathed? 4 out of 25, and I remember tweeting it.
So how many cars actually finished the race? 12?
Probably. We can look it up in the break.
Yeah, well, not a big deal. I'm just curious. But yeah, I personally think it was a wreck fest, and if I was an owner, I would not want to have to do it, but you don't have a choice. You got to be in it because you got to be there. You got to represent your sponsor. You got to. There's so much involved. It's crazy. Mm-hmm.
And then there was Stewart's car, which came completely apart.
Yeah, and who's driving that now? Allmendinger, right?
Vickers.
Brian Vickers. That's right. Brian Vickers.
I mean, that, I don't think that had any piece of the car left on it when it came.
I was
to
actually surprised though they passed Vickers because I wouldn't have thought he'd be ready yet.
Well, they said he was.
Good for him.
I'm glad to see it, yeah.
One, not off topic, but today at school I was working on the notes because I didn't have any work, and I was reviewing Vickers' wreck, and one of my friends comes in and she looks at it and goes, oh my God, did he die? I'm like,
nope.
That looked bad, but...
Thankfully new.
I'm like, that looked bad, but... Hold on, let me pull up some worse picture videos. And I pulled up Danica Patrick's back straightaway wreck at Daytona. And she was like, I'm like, you have no idea.
Who was it that hit the, it was Mark Martin, but I can't remember where it was. Was that Loudon? Where he hit the open wall?
No, that was Michigan on pit road.
Yeah.
He slid in
and hit the, and almost folded the car in half. It actually went right behind him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's pretty severe. That was a pretty scary wreck.
Yeah, and now they have those K-walls on the entrances to pit road. This way, you're not impaling a car. You're hitting the wall instead, which, of course, we never want to see a car slide onto pit road because they're
people
unarmed
cars.
People there. But anything else on the Unlimited?
Nope.
One thing that we'll talk about later on that can connect to it is the nice green-white checker procedure that we got to see in action, and I know you're already going, how does this work? Do you understand it?
Nope. I'm confused also.
All right. Well,
I'm totally
confused. I did my homework, and I kind of understand it.
So we race to what?
Well, yeah.
Go to break, and then we'll go to it afterwards.
So on the other side of the break, we're going to talk about the Daytona 500 qualifying. Yep. We're going to preview the sprint, the Can-Am duels. And we're going to... also talk about the final lap and preview speed weeks for you guys. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back live here to Racing Hotspot Weekend Roundup. I just want to say you're probably at a better angle because of the camera, but I feel like the camera's not even getting me. Because like how I'm used to being like here, and now I'm feel like I'm on the outside.
Definitely
of the
in the picture. Definitely in the picture.
I can't smell you no more, so I like this.
What are you talking about? Smell me. Anyways, so we decided we're gonna explain the green white checker procedure first.
You know, I was just thinking about what you said. And this was off air, but I was just thinking about what you said about how when we're at the track, people will be able to see.
Be seen on camera.
Yeah. You do realize that some of the nutcases are going to run right up to the table, right?
We're going to have a nice thicker rope in that section of.
We'll see. I was just thinking about it, and Like a couple of the nutcases we had in September, they would be right. They'd be right in here. Yes, yeah, I'm very yes, should have seen the race. Yeah, anyway. But yeah, we're yeah. Did you think about that? Yeah. The fact that you're leaving? Okay. I don't think you need to rope anything in your defense.
Electric one?
Like a 6-foot chain link with the with the electric. Because they're gonna come right up.
Hey,
people,
you know what?
People like to be done. I mean, you see it all the time on the real, you know, on Fox and whatnot, where
they're doing it right. They're elevated.
They're elevated, but you still have the people in the background every time they know the camera's pointing at them. So yeah, if you got a camera and it's pointing, yeah, we're gonna have friends.
What do you think? Should I put a sign here? You're being recorded. This way people on the tram are like...
They'll all come then.
Well, no. It's only going to attract them.
No, but people on the tram are like, what the heck's going on? When they see it, they're like, hey! No? Okay. Whatever.
They might.
It's just an idea.
Well, you kind of had that street side already, so...
Well, yeah, but they're over there, and it's like, hey! Cameras
are... No, I mean, the signs are out there already, so people going by know what's going on, or they can see what's going on. So...
Fair enough.
If anything... political sciences make some noise or something like that.
That works.
So we'll come up with something.
I was going to say, we'll have a production meeting in like June.
Moving on.
Anyways, so we decided we're going to explain the green-white checkered protocol now, and then we'll go over the 500 qualifying results and preview the duels and blah, 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 blah.
First question I have.
I didn't even start explaining yet.
There's not actually a green-white checkered thing anymore.
Could you please raise your hand?
Excuse me! Excuse me!
Yes.
There's not actually a green-white checkered rule anymore. That is clearly what they stated the other day. That's gone. It's a totally new rule.
Yeah, well, they still call it the green-white checkered procedure. But it's different because when you have the car start... markers are over there. Have the car start, they go over the start-finish line, They have to get to this overtime line on the back straightaway. Now, it'll be placed at different points around the racetrack. I know some of the viewers are looking at, watching this, going, Fox Sports said it was in turn 3, because on race day, they said it was the turn 3 line. But like they have at NHMS, they have a timing and scoring loop line at the end of the back straightaway. Well, Daytona has that too, and it's been there for years. So I don't know what the fuck we're looking at. Anyways, so basically, when you have an overtime like we did in the Sprint Unlimited, your drivers go over the start-finish line, they go around turn 1 and 2, and if they get to this line without wrecking, we have an official green-white checkered. As soon as they get to this line, they...
Meaning what? What do you mean? We have an official green-white checkered?
Meaning...
Do they start over again?
No, meaning that anything that happens past this line, if they wad up in turn 3 and wreck... They get back to the white, and they wad up in turn 2, or they get all the way back to the checkered.
It's whatever happened at the green line.
It's not green, but the overtime line placed anywhere on the track.
And they only take one shot at it.
Well, if they restart, and they wad up in turn 2, NASCAR calls it off, and they reorder them, and they go again.
Gotcha.
And there's an unlimited amount of restarts until they make it to this line.
Okay, that makes sense. That's very logical too.
I think it's a safer idea.
A much safer idea. Yeah,
it's a safer idea. So, but is that going to apply to every track or just the super speedways?
Every track.
See, I don't agree with that.
That's what
I think. The green white checkered rule, the way it was definitely better for tracks like Loudon. Anything a mile and a half or shorter,
because you don't have the space, you don't have the time to get back. Because, like, here you have a good 15, 20 seconds for anything to happen. And then at Loudon you have maybe 10 seconds.
That's my point.
Yeah.
I think that they should stick to the
regular rule. You're saying then that if they pass the...
Overtime line.
And they wreck, that's the end of the race?
So they pass the overtime line.
So that's even at Bristol? That's even at Martinsville?
I believe so.
Yeah, that's terrible. Super speedways, I can understand it because of the danger involved, but I think that anything mile and a half or less, they should have just left it alone the way it was. because I'm...
Because it was...
I mean, how much can happen at Loudoun? You know what I mean? It's...
Yeah. I don't know.
No, a lot can happen, but, I mean, it's not anywhere near as dangerous as doing 199 miles an hour.
Mm-hmm. And basic reason why they did this is because Talladega last year.
That's what I'm saying. Super speedways.
When Kevin Harvick wadded up the field here and they made it to 2 with this overtime line, they would have reordered and gone again. But example on Saturday night, they made it to the line, they came around, they got the white flag, and then they crashed over here.
Yep.
Now my dad had
like almost immediately.
Yeah, my dad was watching it and he looks at me and goes, That's it, Hamlin won. I'm like, they didn't call a caution yet. And he's like, but they made the line. I believe it's the same rules as last year. If they wad up here, even if they made it to the line, they can still race back. NASCAR has to make the determination if their track's going to be clear by the time the field gets back around.
I believe that that's actually how the race finished. They did make the line.
Yeah, well,
and they raced back.
They made this line, then they got the white, they wadded up in turn two, and then when they were around the back straightaway, they called the yellow because I believe Truex was turned around.
Okay.
I guess we really just need to see it in action more.
I really think that this seems more of a super speedway thing to me, but okay. I've been watching this stuff for a long, long time. Actually, started realizing how long it's been. Reality? Well, you know what informed me how long I've been watching racing? Jeff Gordon retiring. After a whole boatload of years, I watched him come up and in. It was a joke in the beginning. It was a little mustache and Earnhardt making fun of him. I remember that like it was weeks ago. So, yeah, I've been watching this for a very long time. Another thing I learned, by the way, that I thought you might be interested in that, Mark Martin was actually Jeff Gordon's original, I can't think of the word for it, damn it.
Partner? Mentor?
Mentor, thank you. They were with a small team.
Yes, right. I remember reading it.
We read the same thing. But
if you read NASCAR Illustrated this month, which you just got, I just gave it to you,
mm-hmm.
There's a whole page on Mark Martin. And what he's doing now, and the fact that he doesn't go to the races at all.
Well, he doesn't live in Miami anymore either. He went home.
No, he doesn't. He moved.
He's back to Arkansas.
Right.
I read that recently, too, myself. Yeah. I didn't know that.
But in no way is he interested in getting involved again.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah.
It is sad. It's very sad because he was terrific.
Hey,
well, I think that he was really kind of really looking forward to... his name Max,
his son
getting into it, and then his son just decided out, and his son's probably gonna go way further, but very smart kid, but it's just kind of sad. The kid just turned around and said, you know what, Dad, I don't want to do this, and that was the end of that. So I think at that point in time it was when Martin started to close the doors and saying, yeah, it's time. And you have to admit, you made it further than most drivers. When it comes to retirement age.
Want to make a day trip to Arkansas?
What do you mean? You have to go to his dealership or something?
No, to interview him. I mean, if he's got a lot of time on his hands.
But that's just it. I don't think that he wants...
No, it says in the article he does not have much time on his hands. He has 3 dealerships, and he's starting I can't remember what they called it, but kind of an off-road dealership for ATVs and off-road vehicles. He's starting that. So he's been staying very busy.
I know last year he was still involved to an extent.
Hmm. Well, regardless, that's the overtime rule. And...
I understand it for safety reasons, but I don't believe it's applicable to smaller tracks. But I don't make the rules.
Maybe NASCAR
will. I think that at the bigger tracks, though, it's a damn good idea. Just for safety. Just so these guys aren't getting crazy. Because, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of money on the line. They're going to do whatever they can to be that guy. And unfortunately, sometimes that might bring them near... fatality, so Especially tracks like that. I mean, what were they running on the first practice? I forget what I was watching. It's like 299.5 something miles per hour.
199.
I'm sorry, yes, 199. Sorry.
He said 299. I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Well, NHRA was last weekend.
That's what my truck does now. Actually, it was this weekend, wasn't it?
Yeah,
no, 199. It was like just short of 200 miles an hour. And that was lap speed, which meant in the backstretch, they were doing in excess of 212 miles per hour. But then I noticed the next practice, they were slowed down by like 5 miles an hour. Did anybody catch the rule change or something that NASCAR did to slow them down?
No. NASCAR went, holy cow.
No, they probably did. They probably they probably
looked and said,
Pull out the backup, restrict your plates.
I would say it was probably something more about downforce or something like that. They added something that changed the... the rear spoiler or something to that extent, but I'd never heard anything about it. I just noticed that in the second, the main practice or the final practice,
was that at night?
That they were literally at 193 to 195.9 kind of speed, as opposed to borderline 200. It was the Busch brothers actually. The Busch brothers were borderline 200 miles an hour in the first practice. They both capitalized and totally walked away from everybody else in that practice. Second one was a little bit different, but they obviously weren't ready for whatever change got made, but I never heard anybody say anything about NASCAR stepping up and saying, all right, way too fast, we got to do something to back this up. And I don't blame them. I think it would be the right thing to do. Because if you're doing 212 miles an hour in the backstretch...
by yourself.
Going in, yeah, going into turn three... yeah, that's really, really fast.
Well, no, think about it, too. By yourself. All right, let's line all four of these cars up and go, whoa, 230. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, of course, IndyCar does that on a good day with the Indy 500 in Indianapolis.
But it's a very different car.
But yeah.
Very different car, very different suspension.
Let's compare the two here.
Well, those are basically the way I've always viewed those. They're insane go-karts. And then you go to Formula One, and they're really, really, really insane go-karts.
Oh, by the way.
Although these guys are actually, from what I'm reading right now, these
coming
guys
up there.
Are actually going faster now than Formula One. Formula One has implemented so many rules that they've got the cars drop down speed-wise. And these guys are going up an arrow.
By the way, you can take your Indy car back. It's right there on the shelf.
Did you clean it?
No, I didn't. I'm giving it back the way you gave it to me. So it's a little cleaner.
Wow. All right, let's go.
So yeah, that's the overtime rule. We'll probably talk more and more about it as we go on through the show.
I'm just hoping that they're going to keep it for only super speedways, but whatever, we'll see.
So, Daytona 5... okay. And they see you come back online.
I like screaming at the green white checkers.
Daytona 500 qualifying. Go to my grandfather's house. Hey, Chase Elliott got the pole. Huh. Couldn't have seen that coming. In all honesty,
actually, he saw that coming. He said it before they even started.
Chase?
Hmm?
No, I know, but the morning of, I wake up and I'm going through practice speeds. I know, I'm a nerd. Going through practice speeds, and I'm like, oh, wow, 10th. I wonder if he could do something. And then I see he did something. I'm like, huh. Wow. Rookies are really enjoying Daytona. Or new full-time drivers. Danica Patrick, Austin Dillon.
Seriously, for real, look who's right behind him. So that is impressive. I'm sorry, I give it to Chase Elliott. That is an impressive qualifier. Kenseth, Earnhardt Jr., Kyle Busch, all behind him. Put that together. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Of course, we know at Daytona that means absolutely nothing. Yeah. And he could be in eighth. By the time they get to the first lap, you know, the first time they cross the... actually, who am I kidding? You could be in 32nd by the time they pass the line the first time.
Off topic here, recap it, or talking about this, one of my teachers is doing DraftKings Fantasy Racing.
Mm-hmm.
And on Saturday, I was at a hockey game, and he was there, and he's like, the Unlimited's tonight, right? I'm like, yeah, good job. I'm proud of you. You know your races. He goes, I just got a notification this morning on my phone, but thanks. I'm like... you're not a race fan. And he's like, can you help me with the picks? I'm like, sure, I'll help you out. So this morning I go into him and he goes, Elliot, huh? I'm like, don't pick him. He goes, why not? He's the fastest. I'm like, is Daytona?
Doesn't mean a thing.
Nothing matters until the end.
Yeah, and I said to him, like, don't get me wrong, people usually on the poll usually end up 10, 15th.
Somewhere in the top 10.
Yeah, but I wouldn't put him as your winner because by the time they get to, like, the third or fourth lap, the driver's behind him right now, because, of course, we know those can change in the duels. But Kenseth can easily just be like, all right, rookie, move out of the way. Excuse me.
I'd actually be curious if your dad knows that you have a teacher that was asking you about that, but okay.
No, he does. He said that if he wins money, we'll split it. We'll split it. Well, it works. He's not going to win. But because him and like 100,000 other people are doing it. Oh, what I'm saying?
Yeah, I was in the DraftKings for a little bit.
Yeah. We're doing
it. Anyway, time.
We're doing a non-money one for the point.
I'm going to get reminders on that, right?
You're through your Yahoo. You should.
So I should get a...
Yeah,
a,
2 days before.
How come nothing from this past race?
There was nothing for this past race. The first race is Daytona.
So it's only points races.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Makes sense. Yeah. I meant to ask you that tonight.
Yeah. So, the duels. Here we go. Darn it. So I'm not used to this.
So you're actually going to pay attention to it this year?
I mean...
So I don't completely destroy you?
Last year was a setup and go, and I knew you were just going to do it. So I'm like...
You told me to. Research. You told me you were going to be doing it.
Research and development over there. Dave Poslusny, number one.
Yeah, I get an email that says, you need to make your picks. I make them. If you call that research, okay.
Anyways, Can-Am duels. Budweiser duels last year. Gatorade duels 3 years ago.
Oh, I just got it. Can-Am is actually an oil company.
Okay.
Now I'm thinking about it. Can-Am, it's Can-Am oil. I've seen it. They're additives, all that stuff. Okay. I've been trying to figure out where that came from, because you know Can-Am, you and me, when I was a kid... Watkins Glen, they had Can-Am races.
Yes, that was the best series ever.
It was Canada American, if I'm not incorrect.
Canadian American.
Yeah, it had nothing to do with oil or a sponsor or anything like that. It was called Can-Am for a very reason. Canadian American racing.
It's kind of like ACT.
Well, just an FYI, they do still run them.
Yeah.
Vintage, which would be pretty cool, actually. I would like to get behind the wheel of one of those things.
So, the duels... Duel 1 is in red, Duel 2 is in green, they're also on the screens. Basically, people always get confused by how they set the order.
Jeff Gordon's in first? No, I'm just kidding.
Basically, people always get confused on how they set the order for the duels. It's like, just take inside line, you're Duel 1. Outside line, you're Duel 2. Congratulations.
It really was weird watching that car go around the track and Jeff being up in the tower. That's all I can say.
But the cool thing, the good thing I like about it is it's a different paint scheme. If it was this car, it's like, whoa. You know what I mean? But it's...
Well, the kid brought Napa with him.
Yeah, I know. But I'm saying, though, it's a different paint scheme. So you kind of make the mental connection and go, oh, right, that's different.
It's been a lot of years.
Whereas if it was, I don't know, I didn't see qualifying. So it might throw me off, too.
Well, if you actually saw the qualifying when he did run the time he did, and they showed Jeff Gordon, you would have swore to God he was actually driving the car because he was so excited. he was freaking out. He was like, yeah. Like, Jeff, you're not driving it anymore.
Jeff, you're in a tux for a reason. Anyways, so Duel 1 consists of 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Duel 2, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10.
Yeah.
Science. So, some notables here. The 21 team has no charter, so he needs to race his way into the 500. That's Ryan Blaney.
Okay.
And the 41 team...
Sester?
Yeah. Yeah, I hope so. Or someone else.
Or one of the dogs running on their back feet?
Yeah. and the 41 team... Failed post-qualifying inspection, so he's going to the rear for the duel. The 4 team is also in the
Kurt
rear.
Kurt Busch did?
Yep.
Why?
Ride height? No. No.
Hold on.
Maybe some hotspot. The 4 team is also disqualified. Both of them for the same reason. And the 78 team never made it out on track. Because of the roof flap issue. Like the...
What do you mean?
He had an issue.
Stenhouse?
No, the 78. So
I thought you said 17.
No, sorry.
I only laugh. I look at the 17. I think it's not Allison. And as far as I'm concerned, you mentioned Danica earlier, but I'm just going to go ahead and say, oh, she'll find some way to take him out. Because it seems to always happen. The two of them, I'm not sure if they should be dating. Makes you wonder if something behind the scenes comes out on the track. You'll start dating soon enough, Devin, and you'll understand where I'm coming from with that one.
I know what you're... it's not telling me. The 78 team halted because an issue with the right side roof flap.
Sorry?
Right side roof flap had an issue. So NASCAR halted their team.
Okay.
And
it doesn't say what issue, just had an issue?
Said being out of compliance.
I would love to have that amount of energy. Would you not love to have that amount of energy?
Yes, I would love
to. Sorry, but we're listening to Devin's sister upstairs running up and down the hallway. I don't know if you can hear her on camera, but man, would I love to have that amount of energy. I'm lucky if I stay awake more than 20 minutes from the time I get home. Only because I have to go out and deal with all this weather.
Oh, shoot. I'm sorry, folks. It wasn't the 41, it was the 14. Wow, that comes off.
It's a 14.
And to think about this, we can't fire him.
We're found with track bar out of compliance with NASCAR specifications.
Ah, I did hear that.
Yep.
Yes, I did hear that.
Harvick
actually, I
posted the 14th fastest time and Vickers 21st before qualifying were disallowed. So they'll be at the back of the pack. Fourteen.
Okay.
Ignore the scribble.
Right.
Oh, there you go.
There you go. That's better.
I was gonna say, I just literally crossed off bottom of the 17 with no problem whatsoever.
The green doesn't come up.
Are you using the right kind of says dry erase?
Yes.
Okay.
Dry erase.
Wow. You tried, right?
The red comes right up. The black kind of smears.
No, no, the red comes up. I crossed off the bottom. The little checky out at the bottom of the 17. Sorry, folks. Just better than turn the cell phone off.
Oh, yeah, it says 14. Wow. Anyways, so that is the starting lineups for the duels. So it's just the 21 that's in our little lineup here, ladies. Without a charter, and we're still trying to learn the whole charter system, so we'll get back to you on that one.
I think NASCAR is still trying to learn the whole charter system.
Actually, I meant to read about that, because I kept seeing a bunch of posts, even on Yahoo, they had a post about it. What? Does anybody have any idea what is this charter system thing?
It's basically...
36 cars will have a charter. Which means they will race.
Yeah. No.
Everybody else has to work their way into it.
That's kind of how it's always been.
Okay. No. If you didn't qualify, it didn't matter what position you were, you didn't race. Now they're going to race.
Well, they have professional.
You must have a charter.
Jimmy Johnson wrecked out of qualifying seven times. Seven times in his career and still raced.
No,
qualified last.
They had
provisionals.
It was called provisionals. But he had provisionals.
Same thing.
They don't have provisionals, I don't think, anymore.
Not anymore.
Okay, so they turned it into a new word, charter.
No, but there's...
What's the difference?
Hold on.
No.
Here's the thing. Each team gets a certain amount of charters. A team can sell their charter to another team and make money. So, if Stuart Haas Racing... drops Danica this year, or drops Stuart, or drops Harvick, or any one of their drivers, they can then take their charter and go... Hey,
Wood
Penske,
Brothers, would you
Penske
like it?
Penske Racing, you guys are expanding this year, right? You want ours? All right, we'll sell it to you. Thank you.
Interesting. Well, based on what you had just said, by the way, and I wanted to bring that subject also, you are a Tony Stewart fan. You do realize there's a very strong chance he ain't coming back, right? Because he was retiring anyway.
Yeah.
And with a spinal injury in which he... I don't know if you check the details. Mm-hmm. But that ain't funny. He'll be fine. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, because he has the money and whatnot to be able to deal with it. But now I think he's all done. I don't think his doctors are going to allow him to go back with too much risk. Way too much risk. If he gets jolted or anything like that, it could bring him right back to day one. So I've already done all the research on this. You're probably not going to see him back. What I do believe is he's going to be a team owner, and he's going to stay that way. Yeah, he's going to stay that way, and he's not going to let it go.
So Boyer comes into the car next year, right?
That's what I'm understanding, yes.
He's not in it this year. No. Because, right, as we know...
He already had a ride.
Well, yeah, and also Stewart's coming back, so to speak. Right now, people are making that speculation.
Officially, he's... still
he said that
the driver.
Come back,
right, but I think the reality is going to dictate that that's not going to happen.
And even if he does come back, it's not going to be right there. It's going to be kind of just in the back, making sure that he doesn't get hurt. Right?
Kind of like Kyle Busch. He was out for 12 races, and he just stayed in the back and won the championship.
Yeah,
he stayed in the back by winning how many races?
Right. No, if he gets back, if he gets back in the car, he'll go for
his mouth. It was basically a challenge, and that's what happened.
If Stewart gets back in the car, he will push.
I think he'll drive like a regular driver. Yeah, but I really don't believe. I don't know if you did any actual research on what he did to his back, but it's pretty bad. Yeah. So. It's a different situation than Kyle Busch. Very different situation than Kyle Busch. You do realize that Kyle Busch actually had to go in the off season for 2 more surgeries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's in a lot of pain the last 10 races there because of it. He opted to pause it and be able to drive.
Right.
You're just a hater.
No, I'm not. He's wonderful. He's quite a character. The man is special.
He's got a championship. That's all I know.
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did. And not only did he win the championship, he won the actual championship race, which everybody said the champion is not going to win the race. And he still did it.
I wonder if Kyle Busch takes all media as a challenge. You don't think I can win?
Down. I'm sure he gets a lot.
He wins.
Though, I'm sure of that. Because
he wins and he looks in the camera, whatever news station it is. Fox Channel 6, I told
I'll give you honest with you. Sometimes when you really, really view the media's actions with these drivers, it's almost as bad as politics. Mm. It really is. I mean, look what they did to Kurt, his brother. Mm. That was just horrible. And they had nothing, but yet they were doing whatever they could to destroy the guy's life. What happened? Turns around, exonerated, and finished what in the points? Third or fourth or something like that?
Something like that, yeah.
So, that was just, I think that people need to learn to shut up until they know what's going on. It's cut and dry. Right. All right, let's get this done. It's almost 8 o'clock.
I think we're running a little hard here.
All right, so...
what you got on the clock?
You got 25 minutes left on the...
Okay, so...
The way we keep chit-chatting, we're going to use it.
All right, so we went over the overtime procedure. We went over the duels. The duels are on Thursday night, 7 and 9 p.m. on Fox Sports 1. They're saying approximate 9. And over the Unlimited, we talk about Supercross, we talk about NHRA. I believe it's time to go to the final lap.
By the way, when I was talking to you, and I said that I didn't set the practice up for recording, and I was like, oh yeah, I could do it from here. Right after I talked to you, I pulled over. I love that thing. It is just awesome. To be able to literally either watch or set up something from anywhere, it's just awesome.
I just want to say that I can mess with your DVR so much.
I personally think you erased a whole lot of movies.
I did not touch any of it.
I had like 30 movies that
go on. I didn't touch it though, because all I do is, if anything, I go onto your dish and I go to the program guide and then go, bingo. Alright? I don't touch it that.
Are you trying to tell us to stick with the show?
Alright, anyways.
Want to go home sometime tonight, do you, there, Godfather?
Now to look at the final lap here, we are really exceeding the size of our screen here. As you can see, the word final lap got moved over to the left. Right. Right.
If you can see past my big head.
So, yeah, no problem at all, Dave.
Supercross. Really? Supercross. Wow. And he can. And he's saying that you can't see that, but he can see that. That's pretty good.
You can't see it fine here. Yeah. That's... I don't understand that.
So continue.
Supercross. Saturday, 8 p.m. on Fox Sports 1. They are in AT&T Stadium in Dallas. Formula E is off till March 12th. NHRA takes the next week off. Congrats. Welcome to Racing Hotspot. Take the next month off. They're back on February 28th. IndyCars starts their season. What?
That's a week.
I know, but...
Oh, okay. I said month. So
I'm being sarcastic because it's going to feel like a month. IndyCar is back on March 13th. Formula One's back on March 20th. Peter Long is back this season, by the way, as you guys see in our intro. Can't wait to have him back. Rallycross is off till, May 21st. Tudor is back March 19th. They are in Sebring. Now let's get to the actual racing that's going on. The trucks, Friday night on Fox Sports 1, 7:30 p.m., NASCAR Capro Truck Series season opener. The NASCAR Xfinity Series, Saturday, 3:30 p.m. on Fox Sports 1, their season opener. Glad I used my inhaler today. NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, Thursday night. Yes, I said Thursday night. The Can-Am Duel, 7 p.m. and 9 p.m., approximately 9 p.m., depending on how long the first duel goes. They originally said 8:30, and then they moved it back to 9, and that really messed with my scheduling, because, I'm in bed at 10. Anyways, Fox Sports 1 on Thursday night. That will set the lineups for the Daytona 500. And speaking of the Daytona 500, Sunday, 12 noon on Fox. Nap time.
That's the start time?
Well, no, that's when their coverage starts. 1 o'clock, probably, about this, where they start.
1:05. Oh. Never. They're always 5 off.
So,
still pretty early though. Normally they drive into the dark.
They kind of moved it up.
Yeah.
Also, 500 can go long sometimes because
It can.
So and so, there's a huge accident in the back straightaway, and they have to clean up, and then it's a 2.5 mile track, and anything can happen. What are you looking at?
I'm just reading news on social media all season long. Oh,
yeah. So. First show back of the season, our board is cluttered. Next weekend, it will probably be cluttered still with the trucks and the Xfinity and the Cup and the Supercross and that's about it. This week is Speed Weeks, obviously. We're going to use these hashtags, general hashtag Speed Week 16, I think. Then for us, we'll have coverage of the duels and then the trucks, possibly, I'm not sure about that one yet. And then the 500 we'll have coverage of. Saturday, this weekend, we might be going to a snowmobile race over Vermont, which I might be able to use the drone at.
Cool.
If that's the case, we'll post that video.
Have you had to license that thing?
I had to register it.
Okay. Well, it's the same thing.
You can also get a license for it to be an official drone pilot license. Drone pilot. Yeah. Right
you
now.
You need to? I mean, well, I can see registering
to
it.
To fly at certain tracks, you do. Yeah, if you want a speedway.
Okay.
Oh, we'll talk about that in a minute. Off air. But that's going to do it for this week's show. We're actually taking this season serious, as you can probably see from my screen. I have written notes on one side and the actual show notes on the other. So I'm actually week two, and I actually am doing...
I would ask him to teach me how to do that, but all it's going to do is confuse me even further.
Next week, I'm probably going to fall off and not have the notes done, so it'll be back to normal. So, Season 5 is here. We are in it. Remember, hashtag RHC5TH anniversary all season long on social media. Yeah. Anyways.
I'd just say it's probably easy to say pound RH 5th anniversary.
Hashtag.
Pound.
Hashtag.
Pound.
Hashtag.
Pound.
Hashtag.
Pound.
Hashtag.
I'll show you a hashtag. It's when I have a breakfast.
That's not. That's a hash brown.
Close enough.
Anyways.
It's a pound sign. Yes. Godfather?
It's a hashtag.
It is definitely a pound
sign. It is a hashtag.
Nobody ever told me to hit the hashtag on my phone when I had to do the special things.
Nope.
On the,
so it tells you to hit the pound
sign. Yeah, I know, but on Twitter.
Hit the pound sign.
On Twitter.
Please press
the hashtag.
Please press
it's a
pound.
Hashtag. That's How many minutes on the battery do we have left? Hold on one second.
It's time to cut this thing.
That's
Let's
a
go.
Retarded new
hey,
school.
Hey, we don't use that word on the show.
Well, it's a new school thing, and I'm sorry, but if us old school don't want to ever accept it, we will not. So you'll have to wait till we're all dead for us to accept that.
Fair enough.
It's
all
a
right.
pound sign.
All right. So make sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to us on YouTube. That is our three main social media sites. And we're back. So Speed Weeks is this week. Follow us on Facebook for all the Speed Weeks information. We'll just share it all, blah, 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 blah. And then next week we'll bring back the Points Championship, which we're doing on Yahoo Fantasy Racing, which is...
going to be interesting.
Yeah, going to be fun.
Especially when you get a lot of people in it. That'll be really cool.
Yeah, I'm not... I'll talk to you
well,
in
Well, that's
second.
One thing you should be telling people.
We're
going
to talk in a second. Have a good night, everybody. And so long. Later, guys.